Hello, Meg here from PMTV UK. I hope you are all well. I am back with another video to do with acoustics, something I love to talk about, and you probably all know that by now. In this particular video, we are talking about the Martin Dreadnought and why it is one of the most iconic acoustic guitars of all time. Before I dive into this little video, make sure you hit that subscribe button and click the notification bell if you don't want to miss any future videos from Dagan or myself on the channel. So, the Martin Dreadnought, why is this one of the most iconic acoustic guitars of all time? If you watched my Martin history video on the channel that I did a month or so ago, then you probably got a little bit of information on this as I did a brief timeline of Martin and what they created over the years, over the 100 plus years that they've been making and building guitars. And Dreadnought is one of the most crucial pieces that have come from Martin and have contributed to the general wider acoustic guitar world. And for this reason, I wanted to talk about the Martin Dreadnoughts today because they really are iconic and they have become a staple, not just with Martin, but with every acoustic guitar brand that you can possibly think of. If we take it back in time a little bit and think about why the Dreadnought was so impactful and why it was needed, we need to take it back to the early 19th century, where up until that point, acoustic guitars were mostly influenced by a Venetian or European style of guitar building, which was a very small parlor-esque body, a 12th fret joint generally, maybe a 14th fret, but definitely not the scale length you'd see today on a Dreadnought acoustic. And by that nature, these guitars were never overly loud. And if we think about the evolution of music and how it began to grow, especially at the beginning of the 1900s, so think about things like big band and jazz, which were all rising to popularity. These were big concerts with lots of instruments on stage. It wasn't uncommon to find several guitars on stage as a rhythm section. And they would generally all be the smaller, parlor-sized body shapes that were most common at the time. Some of the instruments they would have been competing with would have been things like piano, which we all know is loud. And then you've got brass, trombone, trumpets, saxophones, things like this, which are incredibly loud. And of course, then there's double basses, cellos, instruments that can really carry and have a lot of volume and resonance. Acoustic guitars at this time really would have been struggling to be heard over all of these bigger and bigger performances, stages, venues, and bands. As times changed as well, people are going out to concerts more and more, and you're starting to have the jazz scene grow in different places, the blues scene, and people are going to be wanting to hear the songwriters that are using guitars more and more. By the early 1900s, Hawaiian music was really starting to sweep across America, and this was a heavily ukulele and guitar-based genre of music. Hence, a lot of people would have been getting into guitar, and from a request from a very well-known Hawaiian guitarist at the time, Martin began building their first bigger size, or I believe as requested, jumbo-sized acoustic. Now, this jumbo guitar is nothing like the jumbos that we know today, but it did start off the journey towards creation of a bigger bout, a bigger body, and what we now know as the Dreadnought acoustic. In partnership with the Oliver Ditson Company, which was at the time one of the USA's leading music instrument distributors across the country, they had seen the design that had been made for the slightly bigger Hawaiian model, and they were after something similar to sell in their shops that was going to have more volume, more bass. Hence came the first design of the Dreadnought. Martin designed three Dreadnoughts in this series, the 111, 222, and the 333. They were not that dissimilar from each other, but as you'd see today, there were slight spec differences in amongst the range. To my surprise, and I imagine to all of your surprise, it was said to be a little bit of a flop. Moderate sales, not that much traction, and people didn't really understand it, I'd imagine, at that time. If you think about what people had been playing and how people get used to certain sounds and certain guitars, they would have been used to the acoustics that were around with the smaller bodies, not really aware that these bigger bodies were going to massively help them be heard before microphones and pickups were introduced. They withdrew this line of acoustic and it was back to the drawing board somewhat. Although this original design is not far off where the Dreadnought ended up anyway, the people weren't quite ready for it just yet, but they definitely would be. And one thing that would have made a huge impact the second time around, that the commercial artists of the time, the people who were in popularity, started to use the dreadnoughts. This would have been around 1931 when a second release was introduced into the public, and the dreadnoughts, which we now know as the D series, so the D18, the D15s, the D28s, was first released with the first ever D1. 1931, this did a lot better, and as I said, lots of famous or then popular musicians were playing the dreadnoughts acoustics on stage, and I can only imagine how much this would have impacted and helped the sales and popularity of these acoustics. And with a slight tweak of the wood from mahogany to rosewood on the back and sides, really giving it that full body depth and lots of bass and volume, these acoustics quickly became a staple in the music world. The likes of Joni Mitchell, Crosby, Stills and Nash, Bruce Springsteen, Neil Young, I could name so many more, all used a Martin Dreadnought in the 60s, so even up till that point, it was continuing to gain traction and popularity. In fact, Crosby, Stills and Nash have actually featured the D28 on their first album cover. They are sat on a sofa and they have a D28 Martin Dreadnought with them on that sofa, which would have been the guitar they used for a lot of their writing and a lot of recording. That's one thing that Martin have always been known for, is an excellent, versatile acoustic guitar that is great both live at home and in the studio if you are recording an acoustic. So not only did Martin introduce the dreadnought body shape into the world, the dreadnought name itself was coined from an old battleship and has stuck ever since, not just with Martin, but with every acoustic guitar brand in the world. Dreadnought is how we know this body shape, and it's one of the most impactful guitars that joined the acoustic guitar world, I think, across the history of time. Of course, there are lots of other body shapes you can choose from now, but people will always come back to the dreadnought for that full-bodied sound, that lots of resonance, great bass response, and an incredible range of different tone woods you can choose from. Fast forward to today, Martin have a huge range of both Mexican-made and American-made models that you can select from all the different tone woods, everything from koa top, the Mexican made models, to spruce tops, mahogany tops, and the all solid D28s with the rosewood back and sides, the D18s with the all solid mahogany back and sides, and the Rhodes series, everything in between. There is so many dreadnoughts to choose from, and I couldn't recommend more. If you are looking for a new guitar and you know that the sound of a dreadnought is for you, get your hands on some Martin guitars and try out all the different tone woods. Martin have always been known for that sort of natural, soft sounding resonance and great clarity, particularly in finger picking and folk style genres, which is where you will always find a Martin guitar. I think the dreadnoughts really are one of the most iconic acoustic guitar body shapes, and Martin dreadnoughts in particular have stood the test of time, and it's incredible to see how it went from that original flop to what is now a huge range of all different acoustic guitars. With only a handful behind me, there are so many more to choose from. What do you think about the Martin dreadnoughts? Do you think they are as iconic as I do? And do you own any? Let us know in the comments sections what guitars you play, what's your Martin dreadnought like, what are the tone woods, and what is your dream Martin guitar? Let's have a chat in the comment section and talk about it. Thank you so much for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed, and if you did, make sure to hit that like button and subscribe to the channel. We have lots of new product releases coming out, so you don't want to miss them. If you do enjoy our videos, make sure you hit that subscribe button. We're also on social media if you want to come watch some short form content, or you just want to stay up to date with what we're up to, then come follow us at Play Music Today, and we are on TikTok as well. Thanks again for watching. I've been Meg, and I will see you all very soon.